demo release of Resident Evil Village, fans all over have been obsessed with the main antagonist, Lady Dimitrescu, the mother of a vampire family that's killing their servants and turning blood into wine. Where did Capcom come up with this idea? For that answer, we'll have to go back to the 1500s and look at the woman who has been dubbed by the Guinness World Records the most prolific female serial killer of all time. Elizabeth Bathory. Elizabeth was born in Nyírbátor, Hungary, on August 8, 1560, to a noble family. Her family owned land in the Kingdom of Hungary, which is now a mix of Hungary, Slovakia, and Romania. From a brief Wikipedia search, this family had a powerful military and high-ranking positions in the Kingdom of Hungary. There aren't any detailed descriptions of Elizabeth's childhood, but we do know that she spent her childhood living at Castle Ecced, later renamed as Nyírbátor. According to biography.com, Elizabeth was well-educated and beautiful at the age of 11. One of these being the fact that she was fluent in over four languages: Hungarian, Latin, Greek, and German. But this wasn't the only thing her childhood consisted of. Medicalbag.com says, from an early age, Elizabeth suffered from seizures, losses of control, and fits of rage, possibly stemming from inbreeding within her family. A book called The Most Notorious Serial Killers, Ruthless, Twisted Murderers Who Crimes Chilled the Nation, even played with the idea that she suffered from epilepsy. Back in the 1500s, to treat epilepsy, they would rub blood and fragments of skulls on the sufferer's skull. There's also information that hints to Elizabeth being sexually abused as a child. Biography.com says that she gave birth to an illegitimate child at the age of 11. And Valentine Penrose's book, The Bloody Countess, said that it's possible that Elizabeth was either a lesbian or bisexual who had an incestuous relationship with her aunt Clara, who herself was supposedly a murderess and sexually insatiable. Hi, thank you for listening to the podcast. If you enjoyed what you've heard so far, try listening to Vampire Fitness, an EP album created by American drag performer Katya Zamolodjikova. You can find the album on all streaming services. Happy listenings! Now, back to our podcast. Besides sexual trauma, she was also exposed to extreme violence. Medicalbag.com says, as a child, she witnessed the brutal punishments handed out by her family's officers on their estate. One story describes a gypsy accused of theft who was sewn up in the belly of a dying horse and left to die. This website also talks about how her uncle taught her Satanism, and that same aunt taught her about sadomasochism. At age 15, she was married to Count Frederick Ndassi. Kimberly Ill's book, Infamous Lady, The True Story of Countess Elizabeth Bathory, In 1578, her husband became the chief commander of the Hungarian troops, leading them to war against the Ottomans. During this war, Elizabeth had started to kill. Between 1590 and 1610, with the help of her servants, former nurses, and even local witch, Elizabeth was able to kill hundreds of people. Biography.com says, one witness stated that Elizabeth herself had listed over 650 victims in her papers. Elizabeth's first victims were peasant girls, aged from 10 to 15. StrayDope.com says, peasant girls who have been hired to work as servants were sometimes killed on their first night on the job. Some were forced to eat the flesh of others, and some were forced to eat the flesh of their own. Others were starved in the dungeon and torture chambers that the Countess had installed in her various castles. She also had an iron cage fitted with blades so that her victim could be locked and hauled to the ceiling and tormented. She also had installed the Iron Virgin, a life-size clockwork doll shaped like a naked woman that would embrace the victims and stab them to death. And there are even more stories. Bathory.com also says that sometimes Elizabeth would sew a girl's mouth shut, force her to eat her own flesh, or burn her genitals. One of the servants said that the girls were tied up and beaten to death until their whole body was as black as charcoal, and their skin was battered and torn. One girl suffered 200 blows before dying. Another servant admitted that she had taken a red hot poker and shoved them into the mouth of one girl. She said that she placed her fingers in the mouth of another and pulled until the sides began to split open. The craziest thing about this is her husband knew and allowed her to do this. And whenever he came back from the war, he actually taught her torture techniques. For example, in the book, Female Serial Killers, How and Why Women Become Monsters, it says that the Countess stuck needles into the girls. She pinched the girls in the face and other places and pierced them under their fingernails. Then she dragged the tortured girls naked out onto the snow and had an old woman pour cold water over them. She helped them with that until the water froze on the victim, who then died as a result. The book also mentions that her husband had a young girl undressed and covered in honey and made to stand throughout the day and night so that she'd be covered in insect bites and she'd collapse into unconsciousness. His lordship taught the Countess that in such a case, one must place a piece of paper dipped in oil between the toes of the girls and set them on fire. Even if she was already half dead, she would jump. This book also mentions that it was noted that the girls chosen for punishment seemed to be always those with bigger breasts, and that they would be stripped naked prior to the torture. She would throw them to the ground and begin to beat them so hard that one could scoop up the blood from their beds by the handful. It also happens that she bit individual pieces of the flesh from the girls with her teeth. She would burn their genitals with a candle, and sometimes she would bite pieces of flesh from the girl's neck, shoulder, and breast. But her killings came to an end in 1609 after she made the mistake of killing a noble girl. Her victims thus far have just been poor peasant women or girls. girls nobody cared about at all. Even though rumors of her were spreading across America, nobody really cared until somebody of important status went missing. And to hush all of these rumors, almost immediately, officers searched the castle. And when they did, they discovered the bodies of young girls everywhere. Elizabeth and her servants were arrested and taken to trial. Servants, survivors, and the physical bodies were used as evidence against her. But because of her status, she was excused from execution. Her four servants were not so lucky. They were quickly put to death and burned alive. She was charged with murder, and she was, as we would say today, put on house arrest. They actually bricked her into a room, and history.com says that room only had slits for air and food. She survived for 3 years, but was found dead in August 1614. Now, there are stories that hint to all of this being a conspiracy theory, that Elizabeth was really innocent, and because her family was so powerful and wealthy, people wanted to get rid of her. So they created this elaborate plan to get her arrested. And because her family was so rich and powerful, they wouldn't want anyone to know about it. That's why a lot of this information was hard to get, because her family used it to keep the trial a secret, to keep her death a secret. So she would, I personally believe that she's guilty. All the trauma she went through as a child, added together with the fact that she had probably had epilepsy and multiple seizures, is what messed her up. But one of the big factors here being that she was rich. Back in the 1500s, if you were rich, you could get away with anything. I mean, that still applies today, but you can get away with murder today too if you're rich. That's besides the point. People were too scared to challenge you or call you out, cancel you. That happens today with a lot of rich people and celebrities, so times are different. Bonus fact. I didn't include this before because it's most likely false, but it was kind of speculated that she did bathe in the blood of virgins, so that's nice. And it's speculated that she inspired Dracula, which ties into what we began our podcast on. Miss Lady Dimitrescu. Anyway, I think it's time we wrap this podcast up. So, remember that water is life. Tip your local drag performer. I'll see you all next time. Bye.